But you start working inside of the Trump apparatus for John Kelly, and eventually you end up leaving. So tell us why you left.
Yeah, so I served John Kelly as his deputy chief of staff, and he was only there until like August. Then he goes to the White House and becomes the chief of staff to Trump. And during the period that he was the White House chief of staff, there was some stability. Like, he was able to try to get the government to function normally, but that didn't last. And eventually he got pushed out. And Kirstjen Nielsen, who had become the secretary, she got pushed out. And so, like, you start to see the dominoes fall and rumors abound of your names on a list because you're associated with John Kelly and Trump hates Kelly. And so we often talked about it as it's 10-dimensional chess. Every day you're walking into an environment, you don't know who you can trust. You don't know if the people you're working with actually are mission-minded, like, oh, my job is to try to secure the homeland and what's the best thing to do to accomplish that mission? Or if it is about your own ego and your own agenda, this is normal in a political administration, right? You usually have people come in that are like diehard fans of whoever the president is. So that's not abnormal. What's abnormal was like, there was no level of maturity overseeing the young people. So you had a lot of young people, very enthusiastic, that increasingly were being given positions. I think like college graduate being given a position that a 45-year-old would normally take in a normal administration. And that has consequences in terms of the government's basic functioning, as well as the chaos that reigns. So,
did that happen because the mature individuals in the room weren't interested in working with the administration? Did it happen because there was some sort of resignation and people were leaving? That just seems mind-blowing to me. I mean, if I was working inside the government, the last thing I would want to do is hire a bunch of people who are inexperienced to take over the protection of our country from terrorist threats.
And it really was a change over time, because in 2017, you did have a lot of Republicans with previous executive branch experience or legislative branch experience coming into the government and trying to operate as normal. I think many of us just assumed incorrectly that Trump would learn the job and that his immediate small circle around him would learn how to function in government and they would adjust to the system. And that is not what happened. What happened was they played along for a little bit and then they learned enough of the system to then figure out how to go around the system or break the system. So slowly but surely, as people would hold their ground and say, no, Mr. President, you can't dig a moat and put alligators in it. No, we cannot shoot people from the wall, immigrants trying to sneak in, that there's no probable cause to shoot people. These are real conversations. And he would get frustrated. He would get very frustrated when he was told no, because his view of the presidency was one of what his life was like as CEO of his companies, absolute power. I just wake up one morning, I decide I want to do something, there should be no constraints. And when you had people with experience say, no, no, you can't because of X, Y, and Z.
Hold on, I just got to ask, the crocodiles in the moat, is that a metaphor or
no.
Was that serious?
No, no. We had to go do budget estimates for that. Like that, that was like a real thing.
So you're saying my tax dollars were spent on budget estimates for a medieval approach to solving a immigration problem?
Yes, that is correct.
Oh, gosh. You know, I didn't think this conversation was going to go there, but we might as well just end right now on a delicious note like that, because that is delightful. That is hilarious. So anyways, you're working in this administration. You're surrounded by people who are inexperienced or immature, who to me sound a bit like fanboys over the existing president. Why do you end up leaving?
I mean, confluence of events. One, my husband very reluctantly let us go back to DC and he gave me 2 years. I got a third year out of him. By the summer of the third year, he's like, what's your exit strategy? And so I started working on it then. But around the time that he and I are having this conversation, El Paso happened, the attack at the Walmart. And my job at the time, I was the assistant secretary for counterterrorism. So we had been seeing domestic terrorism explode from a statistics standpoint, but statistics always lag, and government statistics in particular, really, really bad. So it took us a while to see the trend. If you look at the data now, you can see the spike start to happen in 2015, but really wasn't until like 2017, 2018 that law enforcement starts to go, oh, we have a problem. So by 2019, we had these spate of attacks, including what happened in Christchurch, which blew everybody's mind. We were like, oh my gosh, we have white supremacists in New Zealand doing these attacks. Like, oh, what has happened? And what has happened is we've had this threat on a low boil that has metastasized to a point where I don't know that we can put the genie back in the bottle. It's a very different type of problem than Al-Qaeda and ISIS. Anyway, in the context of El Paso, there, as with most things in government, some of the projects that we were trying to get launched finally got the attention of people in the White House, people on the Hill. And so it created this opportunity for us to create some programs to better address domestic terrorism. So I eked out a few more months out of my husband and stayed until April. In the middle of that, of course, COVID hit. And so that also delayed things. Anyway, so the point was, I, both for family reasons as well as personal reasons, I want to say sometime that fall, somebody was like, hey, are you going to vote for Trump again in the next presidential election? And without even thinking, I was like, oh, no, no way. And it really kind of caused me to pause, because as a political appointee, you are representing the president's agenda. And there were certainly days where I struggled with figuring out how to do that and reconcile it with my faith and with my beliefs. I never had a problem saying no if something was illegal. But there are a lot of things short of being illegal that are just morally wrong, child separation being one of them. And it was a constant battle. So after 3 years, it was very easy for me to see that he did not have the confidence or the character or the policies that I agree with. And so I knew intuitively, I'm not going to vote for this man. And there was a check in my spirit that I really shouldn't be representing him then. So it took some time to leave, but I have a feeling, given what happened in 2020, if I hadn't left, I would have been told to leave, because it was most of the people that started in 2017 got pushed out by 2020.
So just 2 months after you leave DHS, the events at Lafayette Park happen. And I've heard you describe this as kind of another turning point for you. So maybe just remind our audience what happened there and how you saw it.
So the incident in Lafayette Square was tied to the George Floyd protest. And everybody recalls the early summer of 2020. There were a lot of protests.
Yeah.
Some of them were violent. The statistics show that by and large, I want to say it's 93% were not, but some were. And there had been some rhetoric that was building and eventually became a campaign theme of law and order. And around this time, the president was not doing well in the polls. I mean, that context is important. He sees Fox News airing the scenes of rioting over and over and over again, so much so that when the polls were taken in November of Fox News audiences, their perception of the protests were that they were all riotous. I mean, I was asked frequently in 2021 when I would speak to audiences if they needed to be concerned about riots in their cities because of what they had seen in Portland or what they had seen in Seattle. So there was definitely a perception in his core base that these riots were out of control. The night before the incident that you asked about, there had been some protests that required some law enforcement intervention, and it resulted in a church right across the street from the White House that's very famous. It's an old church, and every president during their inaugural events goes to a prayer service at this church, St. John's Church, very cute church. It had been damaged the night before, small fire, easily repairable, but it had been damaged. If Trump is good at anything, he is good at optics. He would get into the weeds on events, not about the substance of what he was doing, but on the size of the stage or the size of the backdrop. So I fully think that it was probably his idea. He comes up with the idea that they should go see the church. And this is the famous thing where he walks out and he holds the Bible upside down. And there were some generals that walked across the park with him that didn't know what they were doing and eventually like peeled off and left because they realized, oh, this is a photo op and that's not what generals are supposed to be doing. But the key thing that really bothered me is that before he walked out there, they sent in kind of riot handling law enforcement and military apparatus to clear the square. At the time, there were a handful of people there. Like, there was nothing violent going on. Lafayette Square is a known location for protests and First Amendment right speech. And they literally spread tear gas. Like, there was no notice. There was no like, hey, we need to clear the square, which the Secret Service has to do all the time. Anytime there's a movement or a helicopter landing, they push people back. Like, they have well-defined protocols for how you handle extending the perimeter so the president can move somewhere. And instead of using those, they deployed tear gas. They sent in helicopters that swooshed very low in an urban environment. I mean, these were scenes from a country that we would consider totalitarian or authoritarian. We would issue diplomatic statements of condemnation if this type of activity happened in one of our allies or enemy nations. We would consider that a violation of human rights. And that happened in an American city, in front of the White House.
I'm Patrick. Thanks for watching this video. If you're passionate about ending tribalism in the church and giving Jesus your allegiance, you're not alone. We have a podcast and a book. They're both called Truth Over Tribe. You can download the podcast on Apple Podcasts or Spotify. You can buy the book on Amazon. I hope you'll check them out.